Hello again. So far, we have looked at the actors, their perception on the problem, and their objectives. We have not yet discussed the problem field itself. The next important step in solving a complex problem is to make the problem field explicit. Depending on what actor's perception you choose, you might consider the following mechanism for the gas drilling case we discussed earlier. The gas drillings influence the amount of earthquakes, and earthquakes cause damage to houses and infrastructure. The higher the energy demand, the more you drill for natural gas. However, if natural gas is coming from other sources, like importing from other countries, there are less drillings in the Netherlands. Also, the use of different energy resources, such as coal, wind energy, or nuclear energy, reduce the amount of gas needed to supply the energy demand. Drawn in a simple diagram, this mechanism could look something like this. As analysts, consultants, or as a manager, you can use the technique of causal diagramming to clearly show the relations between the different factors. Of course, you then need a much more complete and elaborate diagram, as there are many more important factors to include in this complex problem. Here is how causal diagramming works. We use the criteria from the goal tree analysis as in the start. In essence, the criteria represent everything that matters for the different actors involved in the problem. Therefore, things, whatever they are, that influence those criteria are of huge interest. So start by writing down a list of factors that influence the criteria. Do not forget to add practical units for each factor. You want to be able to quantify the value of each factor as much as you can. If you find out that a factor does not have a unit, operationalize that factor further in subfactors. Things like the weather can't have a unit, however, it might be an important factor. So it gets operationalized in wind speed, rainfall, average temperature, etc. Also, happiness or satisfactions, for example, do not have units either. Can you think of subfactors that can represent happiness and that can be measured? The next step is to start linking the factors that influence each other. What factor influences what other factors? Label each arrow by adding a plus or a minus sign to define the relation between factors. The diagram reads like this. If factor E increases in value, then factor B also increases in value. However, if factor B increases in value, then factor A will decrease in value. The relations between the factors are called causal relations. A change in one factor will influence the value of another factor. If you have completed the factors in the causal diagram, have a look at your list of alternatives, your list of means, the one you have identified so far. All these means should somehow influence at least one of the factors in this causal diagram. If not, then the means are no good, as they cannot influence any criteria and thus cannot solve the problem. The other way around, it's also possible to identify alternatives from your causal diagram. Imagine that the criteria represent everything that the actors involved in the problem field consider important. That means that anything influencing a factor in the causal diagram, and thus influencing the criteria via the causal relations, can be an alternative. Whether it will be a good alternative or not is for later. Now, just try to identify as many alternatives as you can. When interpreting the diagram, always look for dynamic feedback loops. When a causal path starts in some factor A and eventually joins this same factor A again, there is a continuous loop influencing all factors in that loop over time.
My name is Els van Dalen. I've been a staff member at the Faculty of Technology Policy and Management of Delft University of Technology since 1994. My areas of expertise are system dynamics modeling and the use of models in policy analysis. System dynamics modeling is a modeling method that allows you to understand the behavior of dynamic systems over time, and it consists of a qualitative and a quantitative phase. And during the first phase, the qualitative phase, we make causal diagrams and then translate them into stock flow diagrams. Then this qualitative phase allows you to go into the quantitative phase, in which you enter equations into the diagram and you can run a computer model and see the behavior of a system over time. And one of the projects, one of the research projects we did in which we used causal diagrams and system dynamics was for a project for the Dutch Council of Public Health and Healthcare. And the objective was to investigate why it was that the adoption of innovations in medical healthcare often fails. So what we did, we conducted a number of workshops and we invited 20 people from the medical field. During the first workshop, we identified factors that were of importance to the adoption of innovations, and we related these factors to each other, making an initial rough causal diagram. So this is the first part of a procedure we call group model building. And then in between the two workshops, we refined the causal diagram and made a basic causal diagram for the second workshop. In the second workshop, we presented the diagram and we asked the stakeholders to identify different measures that would influence the factors in the causal diagram in order to improve the adoption of innovations. So we had an idea of the behavior of the system in a qualitative sense. We could have gone on to make a quantitative system dynamics model. In this case, we didn't, but a quantitative system dynamics model, we would have entered the equations into the diagram, run the computer model, and we could have looked at the impact of the different measures on the adoption of innovations. Even though a causal diagram in this course is very basic, it does lay the foundations for a more extensive qualitative and quantitative analysis of the behavior of dynamic systems.
Hi again. Are you ready for another basic example? We'll take a look at the situation of Helen from video one, who wants to throw a birthday party without causing too much nuisance for the neighborhood. First, we looked at what other actors are present. The next step was formulating different problem statements for the actors and drawing goal trees in order to find criteria to use in a causal diagram. Now we will try to build the causal diagram for Helen. We start with the two criteria, satisfied guests and outside noise level. The question to ask now is, what factors influence these criteria? In our example, the inside noise level influences the number of satisfied guests and the outside noise level. For people inside, the music represents fun, while for the people outside, the music is noise they don't want. The number of drunk guests also influences the number of satisfied guests and the number of outside noise level. When you ask, what other factors influence this factor, you will find a few more factors to add to your causal diagram. To complete the diagram, you draw the causal relations between the factors.
Hello everyone. It is time again to start working on your case and see if you understand the technique of causal diagramming. First, study the text on causal diagramming in section 2.4 of the book. After that, identify approximately 15 factors for the problem situation you are analyzing. If you have less factors, your diagram may become too obvious. If you have many more, it will be harder to communicate your diagram to other actors. You might want to make a larger diagram if you want to develop a system dynamics model. Els van Dalen spoke about this earlier in the video. Part of your list of factors are the criteria you identified earlier. If you have a large set of criteria, try to pick 3 or 4 important ones for the first exercise. All the others will find their way later when you're going to make a more elaborate analysis. Now start from your criteria and relate your list of factors to them. Draw lines of influence and define the relation by adding plus or minus signs. Continuously realize what the relation means. A plus next to the arrowhead means that if the factor the arrow comes from increases, the factor the arrow points to also increases. With a minus sign, it's the exact opposite. If the factor the arrow comes from increases, the factor the arrow points to decreases. Now you have your causal diagram, do one more thing. List the alternatives your actor wanted to implement. You know, the ones they had so much discussion about? Now, as the first test of these alternatives, try to link them to the factors in your causal diagram. It should be possible. Realize that the criteria represent what the actors find important. Their proposed alternatives should be capable of influencing the criteria. Linking alternatives to factors is to both test the causal diagram and the list of alternatives. If they don't match, either the diagram is not good enough yet, or the alternative cannot be a solution for the problem. In this stage, there is still a lot of time to find out. You can still make changes in your analysis and talk to your actors. Let me tell you some very common mistakes we all make when we try to make a causal diagram for the first time. The most common one is badly formulated factors. Factors you choose should be measurable in one clear way. As soon as there is room for interpretation, the diagram is hard to construct and has hardly any practical value. Take, for instance, factors like motivation or the weather. What happens if the weather increases? It is impossible to define unambiguous relations with other factors. The most interesting in the system you study are the criteria. These are what the actors care about. So you always start a causal diagram with the criteria and then define the relations with other factors. In the end, you want to know how you can change the criteria so you can know how you can change your problem situation. Lots of people put down the factors and draw arrows between them, but they don't put a plus or minus sign. Sometimes because they simply forget, but way more often because they just don't know. We see a lot of question marks instead of pluses or minuses. Does it help your analysis if you make a causal diagram and show you don't know what the relation is? Not at all, of course. Most of the time, this is due to badly formulated factors. When the factor is not completely clear, it is impossible to define a causal relation. Good luck designing and drawing your causal diagram, and see you in the next video.